Yeah, that's a very famous, that's, as you say, that is the most famous phrase from that sutra. And we used to say that in the temple every morning. That was one of the sutras we would chant in the Japanese Zen temple upstate New York. It's Japanese, something like Fui shiki shiki sokoze ku ku sokoze something something. And form is emptiness is basically saying that our perceptions of form, which includes body and objects, but you can also say thought form, or the contents of mind, like, you know, thoughts and images and memory and emotions, any conceptualization or samskara. So the thoughts of physical objective form, object form, and mental thought mind process formations are empty, empty of essential, abiding, eternal, true nature, because of impermanence. And so, because all that we're perceiving and conceiving is impermanent, and the very perceptions and conceptions themselves are impermanent, ultimately perception and conception is empty. Empty of substantiality. And that goes to anatta. So anatta meaning no self. And no self is not much different than sunyata, actually. And Gautama spoke about sunyata, but that notion of emptiness, sunya, there's actually a sunya sutta from the Pali, but it was developed far more in Mahayana. And anatta, no self, or insubstantiality and emptiness was originally describing nirvana, or the arahant who's free of or empty of the kleshas and empty of ignorance and empty of any illusion or illusory fashioning. So in one way we're talking about the two views, relative absolute or dualistic consciousness versus non-dual consciousness. And to say that form is empty means that all of our experience of dualism, me and you, or this and that, or yesterday, today, and tomorrow, time and space, self and other, is illusory and ultimately of one nature, or of something, like they're saying, doesn't change. This... to say that it doesn't change is a bit problematic also. And so while the two views are developed, that's a theory or a, you know, one teaching in Mahayana and Tibetan Buddhism, Vajrayana, the relative and absolute. Like, the relative, of course, is the world not only of name and form or dualistic consciousness, but it's also, for us, it's the world of psychology, or the sense of self, and the very real sense that I have unique and complex psychology, and everyone does. And it's very important to, you know, to heal psychological conflict, or to become psychologically healthy, whatever that means. And yes, there is more emphasis these days on that level of practice or self-development, because the lower chakra blockages remain no matter whether the person enjoys a formless jhana or not. And that's the point, is if you don't clear the lower chakras, then any experience of what could be thought to be emptiness, and there's the problem where that's ultimately any experience that we conceive to be emptiness, we conceive to be non-dual, right? We conceive to be the law of one, is itself another conceptualization, or any conceptualization is empty, and then there, you know, this is really very complex. So the focus on the personal, on relationships and personal psychology, is the antidote to spiritual bypass, which is very common in any mystic tradition, where people want to get into the higher jhanas, basically. They want experiences of non-duality, or what they think they are, meaning they conceive this is non-duality. People want, you know, bliss, or cities and magic powers. What people have to understand, which I think we do, and it was well understood in Buddhism from the start, it's just that the human tendency for grasping does spiritual materialism as well as it does material or physical materialism. You know, so there's spiritual materialism, which could be called spiritual bypass, which is associated with spiritual bypass, which is basically, Rob talked about this, neglecting a certain development or getting ahead of oneself to develop qualities pretty much of six chakra, while excluding or neglecting or avoiding or suppressing or not working with the reality of lower chakra blockage. Meaning, the person can go into bliss, but they have screwed up relationships, or their health is a mess, or their financial condition is a mess, or they really don't like themselves, actually, or they still have old anger to family or self, and then they can do a chanting kirtan in the temple, or have some kind of, you know, very transitory peak experience of bliss, or a sense of emptiness. So that's spiritual bypassing, that's a kind of spiritual materialism. Chogyam Trungpa talked about that. It's very common. It happens in Buddhism as well as Hinduism, although more so in Hinduism, generally yoga traditions, where people conceive of the goal as states of consciousness, like the formless jhanas, you know, experiencing infinity of space or infinity of consciousness or nothingness, or, you know, that all of that is then, those experiences are real enough, but then they are conceived in dualistic ways. And so one, the phrase form is emptiness, emptiness is form, is not so hard to understand in the first part, but it's controversial in the second. Ra saying you're not living in a material universe, you're dancing thoughts. Well, that is form is emptiness. So form being any kind of compounded phenomena of body, rupa, our body, other body, objects, physical phenomena, and mind, nama, name, conceptualization, naming activity, samskara, fourth skanda, all of that is not a material universe, as Ra said. It's dancing thought, okay? So it's empty, the form is empty of abiding or unchanging identity or substantiality. It's just a flickering flame that's being named at certain phases, or phenomena in continual change that's being labeled and identified at certain stages. And this was in the movie Lucy, talking about time being that which gives the basis for experience, the experience of time or the fashioning of linear experiencing. So anyway, form is empty, you're not living in a material universe, you're dancing thought. Okay, fine. How about emptiness is form? Well, obviously any conceptualization of emptiness or non-duality or insubstantiality is a conceptualization. And so there's the experience of mindfulness, and then there is, which is ultimately true non-duality, but then there's the experience of talking about and thinking about and conceiving mindfulness, which is dualistic. And so this is why Gautama didn't talk about unity, because there's the common experience of duality, or this and that, me and you, which is called form, which resolves into a kind of unity which is associated with emptiness, meaning this notion, it is a notion that there's an unchanging substrate right? That awareness doesn't change. That's a conceptualization too. Sorry. That's a conceptualization. Awareness doesn't change. Now, clearly that's an experience that there is a abiding substrate. There is this sense of unbound awareness. And Lin-Chi talked about it, and it's not a problem. But to elaborate conceptualizations of the unchanging substrate, or consciousness is the goal, or unbound awareness is the goal, and consider that that's unity, or consider that that's static or fixed or a state of consciousness or a state of being, meaning it is associated with non-impermanence or it's permanent, that can be problematic too. And so that one understanding of emptiness's form, which is the simple one, is that any conceptualization of emptiness, which is normally just people thinking about non-thought, thinking about silence of mind at a steady state, like samadhi. Generally, people mistake samadhi for emptiness. It's not so. So samadhi and emptiness are not the same. Meaning, Ra talked about silence of mind at a steady state, calm abiding, concentration, equanimity, non-production of thought. This is a sort of non-grasping awareness, like mindfulness. That's not the goal, actually. That is a means to the goal, because there still is a very subtle conceptualization going on there, or that doesn't necessarily equate to the cutting of all fetters or desires, tendencies. You know, one can experience nothingness in a jhana or so-called emptiness or silence of mind and say, I've arrived. But actually, that's just a freedom from grasping. So, yes, so you ask, what's the difference between samadhi and emptiness? Samadhi could be called an experience of emptiness, but it isn't the end of the path. You can say that samadhi, true samadhi, is akin to emptiness. But samadhi still involves intentionality, meaning the intention to remain concentrated or remain aware. Emptiness is basically going to be a freedom from all from the last three fetters completely, meaning self-fashioning, ahamkara, self-conceit, any kind of identity, freedom from identity, freedom from the identification process of mind that says this is this and that is that. This is emptiness, this is silence, this is mindfulness, this is unity. Any of that tagging is ultimately gone in full awakening. And so the Mahayanists actually changed the notion of emptiness a bit. Gautama was sort of saying that Nibbana is empty of the fetters and the kleshas and the three poisons, grasping, aversion, ignorance, free of any kind of misunderstanding or naming activity. And that's true, but Mahayanists, who are a little sloppy, because they're not Indian, they're Chinese, and they came later, and they mix in with Hindu mystic traditions, Shiva worships and things, have sort of made emptiness a thing. It's been sort of reified in those traditions. And so to say that, to the very subtle belief that emptiness is a thing or a state of mind, or it's a goal, like nirvana is a thing to get, is another form of dualistic conceiving, and that's also empty. So the notions of emptiness are empty. And so there was a teacher, a guy named Maitripa, who was an Indian adept about 1,000 years ago in India. There was still Mahayana in India. And he made a teaching. You can't really find it online much. It's called Amana Sikara. And it basically means non-attentiveness. And it was a counterbalance for people who are getting attached to mindfulness or making mindfulness a thing, or contemplation of emptiness to be a thing. And so, to reify or concretize or establish emptiness as a state of mind or an identity or something that can even as a thing, it isn't a thing. The goal is basically freedom from all identity and identifications, and it's a whole lot more than a passing state of mind or a passing experience in meditation. That's the point, is that people can achieve samadhi, steadiness, silence of mind in a steady state with equanimity and concentration. That's actually sort of a taste of emptiness, but it's not really freedom from bondage, because the roots of the three poisons, grasping, aversion, ignorance, may or may not, you know, have been cut out. The four awakenings, the four stages of awakening in Buddhism, depend on samadhi. There are four levels of prajna, or vipassana, or insight, or realization. There are four penetrations, and after which there's nothing more done to be done. To call that emptiness is a little simplistic. And so the work is a whole lot more than a temporary experience of apparently non-dual states. And it's helpful, of course, but people use that to neglect the personal. And to the extent that those experiences are concretized or reified into a thing, or the goal has been is conceived of as a thing or a place or a state of mind, or changing and unchanging, that's an ignorance, and that's another empty form. So it's the whole notion that emptiness is form is usually understood as conceptualizations of emptiness are illusory. But you see, a fully enlightened being, we can't really talk about full enlightenment because we're just not there. And so there's a lot of people who spend a lot of time thinking and talking about what they can't know because they just haven't, you know, broken the fetters yet. Me too. So, I mean, Gautama never encouraged excessive contemplation on Nibbana, actually, because people get caught up in imagining what the goal is and then trying to conform their mind to it. That's form. That's illusory. That's just taking absolute view as a, you know, making absolute view of a relative view. The idea is that there's relative view and absolute view. Duality, non-duality, the common sense of me and you versus an experience of deep samadhi or what appears to be non-dual or what seems to be emptiness, and taking that as a thing is yet more relative view entangling. And so relative view, absolute view, they're both views, and views fall away for the one who's fully enlightened. The Gautama has no view. And that's why they asked one Arahan, what's your view? And he basically said, whatever is subject to cessation is subject to origination, which is a funny way of putting it. Whatever dies must have been born. Whatever subject to cessation or ends, whatever ends must have been born, and therefore will continue arising and passing away. That's samsara. Samsara is the cycle of birth and death, which is the experience of continually arising namarupa, perceptions of form or bodies, and perceptions of thought or naming activity, samskara, continual fashioning. Whatever dies is born, and whatever born is dies, And that's his view. That's what they are on set. We went over this long ago. That's the only view, because he knows that all views are empty too. So the two views are also empty. Empty of essential reality. Because any conceptualization is a labeling of reality that is ultimately indescribable or is transconceptual, or reality simply cannot fully be known by mind or concept. That's the point. It can be illumined and realized, but to conceptualize it even into the two views, relative and absolute, which is basically form and empty. You know, form is a relative, the awareness of form or perceptions of form, body form, object form, mental content process, awareness of form or perceptions of form and perceptions of emptiness. I mean, you know, the jhana of nothingness is just a jhana. It's not freedom from samsara. And so all of both relative and absolute views or perspectives of reality or life are views, and therefore they are fashionings. Therefore they are illusory or empty of abiding reality. Reality is not conceptualization, is non-conceivable, is inconceivable. God is inconceivable, like that. And that's the difference, that's the transit from duality, dualistic consciousness, to non-dual consciousness, to freedom from consciousness. And the Hindus may say, well, that's universal awareness, which it is, but to the extent that it's known conceptually, one isn't free of duality, or dualism, or identity-making. Ahamkara is also identity-making. And please take good care of yourselves. Thanks again, see you next time, and good night.